So I think you have a few founds in the room. Now, let's like rewind right to the very start. We were talking back there about sound system culture, and that's really how where Soul to Soul really developed out of, the sound system culture here in the UK. Can you tell us a little bit about that, what sound system culture was like when you were growing up, because you got into it at a very early age, and how Soul to Soul kind of developed out of that?
Well, for me, like growing up, particularly in North London, 70s was a wonderful time, yeah, without a doubt, you know, both musically and I guess culturally for us here. So, yeah, Sound System was our life. Well, all right, football and Sound System was our life at the time. And for us, it was something that was very unique, you know, to our community. On both sides, the integration, as it were, and everyone loves music, right? So growing up, I always wanted to, I guess as I evolved, I always wanted to make this something that I lived every day. And I guess taking on the sound system, moving it from a part-time thing or like a hobby, because everybody had a sound system back in those days. And it was really interesting, growing up, there was always the youth sound system and then the big people sound system.
Right.
So, of course, I always wanted to be a big people as a youth, you know, which most of us, I guess, did. I was always fascinated by hi-fi from, you know, the blue spot gram all the way through to, you know, thinking that there were little people behind the gramophone at the time and crawling up. But one of the things that really used to excite me a lot was the smell.
There
was the smell of the valves and the horse hair and the glue and the kind of timber that was used, you know, to put together those sort of things. And as well, you know, the dust and things like that, it all became a part of it. My first sound system was this little leak. Till 12 plus or something that I tried to crank up, you know, messing around with the ohms and stuff like that. And then watching my big brother's sound systems following, you know, everybody from, I don't know, some obscure sounds like Silver Camel, you know, and there was always the old big sound systems. But my brother had a sound called El Rico at the time. And around North London, that side, and they had a nice sounding sound system. So I guess, like, I need to top that.
And how important was it to your community and to, like, first generation immigrants of the Windrush generation? How important was sound system culture to your community?
Well, it was all about us. That was the unique thing about us growing up at that time. We wasn't really represented in the mainstream at all. So the sound system was everything, the news, the drama, the love, the romance, and again, the music. It did so much. It fed your heart, it fed your soul, you know, it took you over to a different place. But one of the unique things for me, I think, particularly in North London, was how, I guess culturally, it was mixing, it was getting, we were blending, you know? And within the realms of that blend, coming up in the 70s, moving away from things like, you know, the big valve amps and the trashiness of that side, because I guess, you know, even the idea of the carpenters building the cabinets and stuff like that, it wasn't until a little bit later on we got into things like porting and making the sound more efficient. That was me all day long.
Now, you're really into community, and Soul to Soul was more of an idea that you had in the late 70s before you even put out an album in 1989. And it was a lot more than just a group of musicians or DJs. It was all encompassing. I mean, it was like a funky dread lifestyle.
Well, I mean, the ethos of it came, I mean, way back when. Myself and Daddy Harvey, we were in school and both of our brothers were in this other sound system. And we actually started off you know, Clear Memories, the Queen Silver Jubilee, 1977, and played my sound in the street, you know, and from there I was never going to let it go. And the idea of the community, everything, et cetera, sort of outside a church, that was your practice, you know. So whether it was in, you know, a party or, you know, all of the things that we used to do that I guess some of us took for granted, I guess that's where we carved that craft, you know.
What was the aspiration or the message that you were trying to instill with this community and with Soul to Soul?
I do get asked that a lot, and you know what? I just made it up.
It wasn't that deep at all. You're just kind of winging it, right?
You know, what was interesting, I guess, is when everybody else started to connect with it. And I guess as an entrepreneur, you always understand once somebody else is interested in your shit, it's like, whoa, okay, this is, you know, guarded grill kind of thing. But no, in the beginning, it was just like any other section of people, bunch of guys getting together. This was our thing. This was our, you know, fantasy. And I guess it all became a part of that. And we put this idea of us being entertainers inside of this whole thing. And I mean, we took a ton of blows as well because we were looking to, like, extend the idea of basically... I wanted to be part of the biggest sound system in the world. And technically, what is that? So like every other step that came along, you sort of made up up things. So we went from, you know, playing in the drama lessons, in the drama classes. I remember my first big gig was Michael Sobel's Sports Centre back in the day, you know. We played there. We used to play in the drama class at Tollington Park. Caxton House was like a hub that you, like that was Wembley, you know? Yeah. If you got to play in Caxton House as a youth sound, that was like you playing at Wembley, you know what I mean? So you can see the idea of how growing up working class with the idea of football and whatever that meant, we took that on within our sound system. And we used to spar with everybody.
Like who?
Everyone from, I remember playing Finsbury Park and... my little sound system playing against Scrap Iron, which was a big sound system from over near South London. We played with Just Shaka. We played, as a youth, even like I said, as a youth sound of us kind of coming up. So many different sounds, FBI from Forest Gate and them sounds. Them times, like Bobby and Steve used to have their little zoo beat thing going and that. I can go back to the days of playing, I can't remember what Dean and that used to call their sound, Shock, I think they used to call it, Muswell Hill. Community centres was a big thing. Stanhope Road, I used to do a Sunday afternoon thing with my sound there just to, you know, develop the idea. Colleen, one time I built a sound that I put in the middle of the room. We used to call it the hexagon system.
Wow, so the speaker's pointing out?
Yeah.
Wow.
You know, things like that. And like I said, forcing the envelope. It was always good jib when you had the older sound men come and see you or hear your things, you know what I mean? Because they would put a ton of cussing under you, whatever. But I guess some of the things I knew from earlys, like maybe, you know, what to do. And I had fond memories of house parties, and people used to bring their hi-fis to house parties. And the guys who had a little bit more money, they'd bring their tannoys and their stuff like that, you know, to play in the house. Their Celestian Dittons and stuff like that on their Marantz and Sansui amplifiers, you know. But I guess I had an idea of how we would be even better than that. And I took the idea of the PA, the sound system, and dealing with the idea as a producer, sonically where you needed to go. And I had a lot of great teachers behind me, you know.
Well, on top of the sonics, Politically and socially, like, how are you kind of representing or responding to the black experience in the UK at that time, late 70s and 1980s? Did you feel marginalized and you had to do it yourself? Is that, was that part of the ethos? Or did you feel you had to build your own thing because it wasn't, it didn't actually exist?
You know, the sickest thing about all that, this was just like normal to us, you know? None of that. Yeah. Was involved in it. We just did what we did because we loved to do it. It was our time where people really didn't understand. Because looking back, I could make up a ton of bullshit about, yeah, we tried to do this, we tried to do it. Look, we were a bunch of young kids out there carving our way, and we were looking at examples and people out there, everyone from Emperor Roscoe to big sounds like Fat Man and all them kind of people like that. Again, the time when we grew up, it was very eclectic. It was, it was, you know, looking back now, it was an incredible time of, you know, we didn't have any inhibitions, you know.
Yeah.
Whether it was live, positive, whatever it was, whatever, you know. I mean, we drew, you know, even thinking about right where we are here today, you know, I had a 24-hour party across the road there, right under St. Pancras International train station. Shit, we had the venues as well in London, do you know what I mean?
And the Africa Centre too.
The Africa
What was the Africa Centre like? Can you tell us, like, what the atmosphere was like when you were holding a party there?
The Africa Centre almost epitomised everything what we were trying to do. And the reason being, it really wasn't a nightclub. So it resembled the hall. And then with all the ideas of what the Africa Centre was about, you know, it was a refugee place and blah, blah, blah. And even when the old Bill used to knock us every now and then, you know, we always knew where to go, how to take it, making it back into the place was just in the wickedest geographical position you could be in, in London. And imagine you're a sound system. Well, we chose the oddest day, a Sunday. That's how brave we were. More time, we was even more fired just to call the album Club Classics. Because there was territories that wouldn't, you know, took off the Club Classics bit. Well, we had a ball.
Well, let's talk about the album too. You're talking about how eclectic music was back then, and that is certainly represented on Club Classics Volume 1, where you can hear the influences of reggae, soul, funk, jazz, house music, hip-hop, African music. It's just all kind of in there in this beautiful kind of fusion. But was there initially an idea to create an album? I mean, you started off doing a series of dub plates, perhaps. How did it all come about?
Again, go back to the sound, you know. if your sound to be reckoned with, you had to have your own music, you know. Also, we were going through a little funny patch there where, as English black kids, we didn't think we were getting any recognition as well. So making your own music or the dub plates, for me, romantically, was a part of, I guess, again, forcing the envelope. And we were heavily into electro or hip-hop at that time as well, and everything that was new. So our bread and butter was always reggae music and roots and stuff, and our argument was really just to bring it to another level. But again, under the guise of us just being the biggest sound in the world, that, that was always, like, you know, I guess our ethos there. Releasing some of the dub plates, again, was like, most people said, just the stupidest thing that you could have ever done. But then at the same time, the idea for me was that I just figured if I couldn't play it any more than what we were playing, and I would get a great response to, you know, the loop that we were playing at the time. I'm just disguising it like that because, again, you know, back in the early '80s, you couldn't tell what your song was. You used to scratch it out. And, and there were so many versions of Fair Play. I had to have, like, literally a version every week. So even in us picking the song out or what it was going to be, that's why Fair Play wasn't on the A-side. because no one got it. They were like, how can you put this out? You know, it's like ridiculous. It's the dumbest idea. But so the record company went for Feel Free. And because I knew about this thing called the double A side, so we managed to flip the script. So we were selling like our side to sound systems and clubs and DJs with the Fair Play, which was like our soul to soul anthem when we would play the sound. So, you know, it was always played. I mean, initially it was a mix of Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream. That's how we used to play on top of it. And then Rose would come on, or E-Mix would come on, or whoever the MC at the time, and then it would go off from there. And then you pull it up, and then you play something else, whatever the hit tune was at the time. And you kept sort of like, as a sound man does, you know, you select your tune and, you know, go and press the tune, like, you know. And then everybody just got into it. And the record companies were like, yeah, let's do this thing. And then I started to feed it out to the DJs, because, you know, I remember coming back from Japan, and then they had called it, they had a name for the style of music.
I'm sure it was a great name.
Yeah, it was something like Grounder Beat or something like that. And everything went on from there, and then it became LA Groove. And then everybody was on this sort of JB's thing. And seemed like Fair Play just fit the bill, you know? And then every DJ wanted to play Knock That Sound. And I think the secret there was where we went with it sonically. So all the shit sounds would sound good. When you play this record, your system will sound amazing.
Because you're an engineer by trade, that's well, why, yeah. So that certainly helped.
It all helped, you know, the engineering, obviously, the guidance from everybody in the crews and what was going on behind the scenes with Nelly and myself and, you know, everybody behind it making it happen, because we were all DJs searching for the perfect beat. And, yeah, we managed to encapsulate it on this particular record.
So what was it like recording the record? Because you were traveling around to different studios. I mean, all these great, Britannia Row. I mean, you were all over London, basically. And what was it like to record the record itself? Because was there a eureka moment you said, okay, we got to do an album, or maybe the record company suggested you do an album, and then you just have to kind of be a kind of like a nomadic kind of recording process?
We seriously had it locked down from the get-go. We were waiting for the record company to come in and instigate that whole thing where we would then be able to go to every studio and find where the best was and blah, blah, blah. But yeah, it literally was Mick Clark and Julian Palmer. Sort of clashing and knocking heads about, you know, the kind of deal that you could have and what was on the table. And then by that time, we've all had fat fingers, so everybody knew what they were, you know, what we were trying to go for in terms of the business and what it could mean to us. So here's Soul to Soul now as a vehicle. And all these other, and all the people, the DJs and everybody in it are just like the passengers, and we're going to these various places and seeking out these various adventures, et cetera, et cetera. And that was more or less how we managed to forge the idea of coming up with this thing called featured artist, all under the guise of being a producer. And then the idea of signing the record deal was that it was so unconventional what we were doing, but again, it is a producer's market in terms of what was going on, particularly with the subsidiary. So you had this idea of you were a band, but plugged into this great machine that produced, you would be able to produce a record and feed it into the machine. And then we became part of that sort of cycle.
Well, it's interesting you said, because it was very unconventional. I mean, it's like this is a kind of a collective. You're the nucleus of it. Did you have any sense of being a trailblazer at that time?
I'm happy to say it was just about being the biggest sound system in the world. It all comes back to that all the time. Yeah. And I mean, even in the sound system, you know, you deal with everything, people's egos, not getting paid. I'm going to say, honestly, now, I feel big to say it now, I pay error. Hold on. I paid to play. Mm-hmm. Now, only sound men understand that. Mm-hmm. You pay to play. Because sound don't just come like that. Mm-hmm. If I buy everything and then look after it, nurture it, understand it, learn it. So it's usually one person in the sound have that kind of dedication. And alongside that, you know, you got your gallus, you got this, you got that, whatever, and then you're fighting with the elements of even trying to get a venue. So when you wrap all that up together with what Soul to Soul was about, even from the earlys when I was playing for Dougie's in Junction Road, Thursday night, things go way back, Palm Tree, you know, trying to juke in all nations and playing the basement down there, all the way to going, like, South London. There was a lot of things going in South London. Plus, guys, there was this whole British thing going on where we divided, right? So the soul boys, the reggae boys, the times, what we were going through. I mean, if you can picture back to the days of the class system and what was going on when there was the difference between the working class people, what you anticipated, that glass roof or that glass ceiling or whatever, against the backdrop of, you know, corrugated iron, people not being sure. You're in London. This is the shopping window for the whole world. So where we're going on being innovative and creative, all of the craziness and sort of wild style of what was going on, it's like we were there planning, you know, in a bedroom or whatever, this is what we're going to do from there and so on and so forth. And because of the time and I guess people's attitude, it's almost imagine like Margaret Thatcher came and turned the whole thing on its head. And as she's turning her head, we just sneak in. You see me? It's like you just sneak in. Because it was a time almost like this is when it's all turbulent and people don't know is what, you know? Mm. And everybody's all uptight and thing or whatever. And it just felt like it was a time we just came in at the right time and just sneak in with the wickedest sound. And it kind of, even people maybe wasn't even so into sound and stuff, you know. I mean, we played a lot of places, so many places, so many places. It was incredible. Mm-hmm. And them times we used to squat, you know, catch a squat, and they can't show you that. So once you know certain things about the law and things like that, and we were all novices, you know, we were all trying a thing, but then somehow bringing up that thing about the class system and then socially how we move and then exchanging ideas and so on and so forth. I mean, all these, you know, we talked about Crouch Hill and Crouch End and then places like that. So there was a different class of people there. And we, you know, every area you grow up, there's a bit of working class, and sometimes that kind of rub off where people want to be like that, you know what I mean? So then you become this spirit, whatever, and then you can be that avant-garde or whatever. Yeah. But then if you've got the knowledge of the, you know, how the law kind of works.
Yeah. Well, it must have been such an incredible, kind of an abrupt kind of change as well, because you're doing this kind of, not, I guess it is underground. You're playing in squats. You're playing at under St. Pancras and train station with Travelers. You're doing the Africa Center. You're doing community centers. And all of a sudden, you're on a major label. You have this record come out, and it rocks the world. I mean, that must have been quite intense to deal with. What kind of, I mean, were you prepared for its success?
Sounds like I missed out so many things, you know what I mean? Mm. I had shops from a long time ago, you know? So we had to have, like I said, when you pay to play, you had to have revenue. Mm. So that's what we had, and we had shops. Then we were all in the music thing, so I used to bootleg records. Everyone had a record store. Everybody bought records. It was what records? That was the thing, and we'd go that extra mile. So once I found Leo Sonship, that was it. Mm. back to the pressing room in Kingston, Jamaica. All our records were pressed right there. We're in the reggae thing, you see me? So all of those things is how we're kind of moving. We're now chipping off the block of all things that are known to us. You know what I mean? Like you would go, Chris, Music House, cut your dub plates upstairs to Kentucky Fried Chicken shop on Seven Sisters Road. And you can't stamp on the ground because the cutting lathe is there, you know what I mean, and stuff like that. And things like that I understood because I worked as a sound engineer. Maybe some of you don't know, but I was Richard Dodd's assistant for like 2 years. I worked for Tommy Steele. And I used to control a lot of the studio sessions that would happen between Bryanston Street and Pi Studio up in Marble Arch. And that was just how it used to run in those days. So I had the teaching from Pat, from them earlies, you get me? So I worked in those places. And that's why I kind of musical, where I knew the technique about using oxide to play something at a high level. They didn't know that. A lot of sounds didn't know that. They were still playing around with their Thorons or whatever, BRS turntable. I was running tapes.
Yeah, it's just great sounds.
An incredible sound. Yeah, so a lot of my people that we were playing against, they wouldn't know that. You know what I mean? And then we were doing all kinds of like things like that where I remember even turning the system around to the people and just having people look at us. And we were still playing and behaving like a sound system and having an attitude. And then everybody wanted to do the same thing and they became part of the whole thing. And that's how the inclusiveness of it became to be a part of it. And I suppose we always loved great things. Having the fact that we had a means of money meant that we had our own style.
Yeah.
So we were selling our style on the market stalls. A great man gave us a fantastic opportunity in Camden. And everything what we'd done, you know, we were looking at mainstream and then making our own version of mainstream. And that was the thing where people could relate to what it was. And then they wanted to have a piece of it. And often enough, I think, especially with sound people, once they see you can do it, they're going to do it.
Yeah.
And that was a nice thing to have, particularly in our communities.
To be like an inspiration, really.
Yeah, or the fact that I felt like a control freak, so everything I would do, as long as they would copy it, we were on it.
Right.
It was exactly. Because, you know, for the hundreds of things that might have happened, there were millions of things that failed. And it still comes back to this idea of pay to play. So I forced the thing, even when sometimes when people would think, well, you must be raking it in there, Beres, and this, that, and the other. So all them speakers and all them things, that cost money.
Yeah,
you know, it costs a lot of money. And then I worked, me and H done a couple of sneaky things. I used to work for a company called Theatre Projects. And used to do installations as well. So we're the first people who used like dual concentrics on that level. And in a funny way, without realising it, that was going back to the early house parties when people used to bring their hi-fi. And it was such a great sound, like a fantastic sound, like you're going to hear in a minute, right? All the acoustics are right and everything. So we did that as a sound. So we lowered the volume and just went for beer quality. There used to be a sound called Fresh Beat in the earlys. It used to play up in West London. Oh. Sound was incredible. You heard, I mean, I might have got into disco music listening to Michael, actually. Because the way it sounded was amazing. Yeah. So sometimes you would take snapshots of certain productions and stuff like that. And that's how I used to want to tune my sound. And I guess most sound man, that's what you do. You have these records, you have this spiritual awakening, and you're going to tune up your sound to be like. And in order to do that, Colleen, it costs a lot of money. And there's not a lot of loyalty in sound systems, really, because, you know, it feed us all, so you take what you can.
Yeah.
And I suppose the difference with me, yeah, I took it really seriously. I took it to heart. Not that other sound men don't take it to heart. but I live it.
Yeah.
I live this thing.
And then once you got into the studio and you were actually making the records, you're thinking about how it's going to be reproduced. So were you very, very careful with the sound and the recording and everything, you and Nelly?
Yeah, myself and Nelly and Arabella Rodriguez and Howie and Tom and Dick and Harry and everybody was in there. Everybody tried their couple of quid in, you know what I mean, to make it happen. Mm-hmm. And the other important thing is we believe we had a reputation. So as a sound man, again, what we were, I mean, I can't tell you how many mixes went on before the final thing. Never mind how many cutting engineers we went through.
Mm. Like, you had to get all the bass because it's a lot of...
It weren't even bass, just getting a cutting engineer that had ears. Like,
right.
like our ears, you get me? Because at that time when we was doing reasonably well, everything was still on, you know, it's not as bad as it is now, but it was still on tender hooks, I guess, because they had to control that power or that energy or whatever. Yeah. So playing, you know, just even things like the broadcasting, knowing that we had to get to this point where it didn't, you know, wasn't out of phase, but then it had this kind of energy, and then there's just so many little characteristics that go with it. But seamlessly, the whole sound or the crew or whatever, we all enjoyed that same passion.
Yeah.
So what was nice about our conflict is like, maybe when you come and play it in my VW, and then you play it in the, you know, like on an SA cassette or some kind of rubbish like a TDK thing or something. or you had to go where the oxide was really rubbed out just to see what was coming back. I remember the thrill, Colleen, of getting every size of speaker we could imagine. Mm. And then ended up with, do you remember the Walkman?
Yeah.
And it had the speaker in it? That was our Auratone. It was a Walkman, like a Sony Walkman. Little thing what you'd just buy, you know, a couple of quid. I guess the Sony was the deluxe version, but you could buy all different ones.
Ferguson. So you're just trying to hear the playback and all the different levels that people would actually listen
to. Yeah, because even in that time, there was a massive car culture.
Yeah.
And sound systems in cars and stuff. I remember even sometimes we used to go on recce and them stupid house guys, not house guys, you know them guys, like acid house guys, and they'd come with their stupid cars and mash up the neighborhood. And often enough, them guys running around in them escorts, they were the ones who set the fire on us, you know what I mean? Because,
yeah,
like, you go out scouting and then these silly guys will follow you with their rubbish sound systems. Met people here while gone 2 weeks before the actual dance, you know what I mean? All of those things were very important to us also as well, knowing that, we felt everybody, particularly in our set in London or like you said, even with the club world, going back to our experiences, you know, I DJed in New York for quite a long time. We went to places like Japan and stuff like that. So we experienced almost an out-of-body experience of being a sound system.
And that was before the album was even released.
This is way before their record was released. But at the same time, maybe seven songs that we were playing, including the instrumentals or at least the bare bones of it, was always my backdrop in where we were DJing. And often enough, Nelly would be with me when we're DJing. So he's like cranking everything up and doing whatever he needs to do to reinforce the sound. And we really did wipe the floor with a lot of places that we managed to play, including going to, I remember an early set what we did in Ibiza. And at that time, it was, the music was nice there, early 80s, you know. The music was really nice because it was all different kinds of music that it had a theme. So when you check the album now, the idea was that it had a theme. But you have to understand that we didn't even finish the record at that point, but it still needed the theme. And so in our imaginations running wild, we just figured, look, sonically, you would listen to that, but on a nice spliff.
Yeah.
It matter whether you were driving or listening to it on your in your escort on yeah. those little funny headphones or whatever. Sound was the it was the alpha and omega of everything what we did at that time. The sound, you know, it meant so much. And I guess we were coming out of the analog phase, walking into this sort of MIDI and digital world and this uncertainty about frequencies and what you could squash and what you could open, kind of cartridge you were using, you know what I mean, and stuff. Remember back in the days, you could make noise with your hi-fi though, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, people used to have a ton of Wolfdale and some funny speakers without no colours in it and stuff like that. Even there used to be a system called Dynacord. Oh, but you see, when you play Soul to Soul, True, that sound nice.
Let's talk about a couple of the songs. How did Back to Life come about?
Back to Life was, it actually started off as an a cappella. Mm-hmm. A run out of tunes that we felt was strong enough to go on the record. Mm-hmm. It was an a cappella. I guess I have to own up to the fact that, you know, it's a producer's market. Yeah. They used to say that in the record companies all the time. Mm-hmm. It used to be 256 or 323. So these were the times. You were cut into these times and stuff like that. Make it happen.
Yeah.
And then you listen to some of the great songs and you hear the song resolve itself after the first chorus. You're like, oh, shit. So there was always things like that. But when Karen came with the vocals on this thing, and I'm going to tell you the truth now, she hated both of them.
Did she?
Ask anybody who was in there at the time. Karen hated it.
Why is that?
I don't know. We're still fighting it today. She hated it. So what had happened, we got to the end of the project, and I think it was 8 tracks, and we were supposed to deliver 12, but they would accept 10. So somehow we managed to stretch it out, and we just fling the a cappella on the back end of that. What happened from there was a whole nother story. Prior to that, the boom was Keep On Moving. And that we knew that would upset every person who was in hip-hop, who was about hip-hop, and because we were, again, making our own sound. So we're trying to cut our own teeth, and this is going back from Fair Play. And as I explained to you, even like in the syncopation and what was going on with that sort of sound, it replicated, you know, a rare groove at the time. So now we're big people. And, you know, Feel Free was magic. Feel Free was one of those proper happy accidents. When you listen back to that tune and you know, when you make a song, you can't buy time. Somehow that had air.
Right.
Oh, yeah. It has air. So those elements from there had to come in, and that's how everything, you know, was predecessed by this and so on and so forth. And how we grew with it was just like, sometimes when you're baking, you know what I mean? You just have to keep adding a little bit, then you take out some. Man, when we got to Keep On Moving, that was it.
Wow. And I was listening to the album the other day and listening to Jazzy's groove, and know what it reminded me of? Because it sounds like an interview with you. And that's what Grace Jones' Slave to the Rhythm had. Someone was interviewing her.
Grace
Jones, okay. Yeah. Was that any kind of inspiration at all?
Of course. Everyone was inspiration.
Yeah.
You know, from Gary Bird, Soul Traveling, just keep going. But I tell you, I remember doing it, and Nels would say, oh, too hype, you know, like, chill out or something. I actually had, like, very nice flowers that evening, and I laid down. I just laid down, right, so you couldn't see me in the booth, just lied down. With 87 holding it like that, and just it's my Marvin Gaye moment.
Well, also the thing that I love about it, I mean, there's obviously a lot of all these different influences coming in, some coming from America, like the new kind of house, underground house coming out of Chicago. You can hear this on your album.
Yeah.
Where did you first hear house music over here?
Well, I guess it would have been, maybe my early recollection would have been listening to disco music mm-hmm. and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But we were more into, like, there was a label called Trax. Mm-hmm. And again, yeah. we're looking for sonics. So these guys were cutting, like, you know, fat. The records were fat. Mm-hmm. And these grooves and, you know, anything from Adonis to even stuff that was coming out of Japan at that time. Including things like Tiny Panks mm-hmm. and stuff like that. We had this, it just had this industrial sound. And then, you know, by tradition, going back to club music, which we're all about, you know, I could feel maybe remnants of Larry Levan yeah. and listen to that. And then I come from a school of everyone from, you know, Tony Humphries, Timmy Regisford, and them mm-hmm. guys, which we're all tribal as well.
Yeah.
And again, you know, I used to play in New York all the time.
Well, that's the thing that's interesting, because there's all these influences coming from the States also, obviously from the Caribbean and from, yeah. from African influences as well. But then you create this sound that then gets exported to the States, and it starts being used by American producers. And I was just playing on my radio show, Sybil, I think Don't Make Me Over and Next Plateau. It's like, it's directly from soul to soul. It's really interesting. And do you have any idea? I mean, you won 2 Grammy Awards that year, and you had 2 number one Billboard hits, Keep On Moving and Back to Life. Did you have any idea that your music would become such a phenomenon in the States?
I guess, first of all, it's kind of our music. Mm-hmm. And, you know, quite seriously, it was to really make an effort of making that point that, you know, we could do this. All of the romantic ideas just worked on this interesting accident. But in terms of turning heads and stuff like that, yeah, no doubt. It's a great thing to be a part of. Mm. And it's just even perfect that more time that it is an English thing and it's something that was born and I believe could only have happened here in London at that particular time as well. Mm-hmm. And I guess in terms of it being timeless like that, there was a, you know, it's a real record. It's just a real, real record where sometimes, you know, you can put a bit too much in and so on and so forth and whatever. And again, at that time, we didn't have the levels of inhibitions post-1989, do you know what I mean? Because then everything kind of went a bit crazy after that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I guess going back to this idea of being the biggest and baddest our sound system, mm-hmm. It had to be reflected. And Club Classics Volume 1 was to its fullest.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, I have one more question. At the time that you're making this record, as you said, you weren't really thinking too much too kind of philosophically about it. You're just doing it. You know, you're having an amazing time and you're thinking, you're just kind of going along, going with the motion and innovating, but you're not really standing back and reflecting on it.
No.
30 years later, how do you feel about this album?
Yeah, it's all right.
Well, we're going to take a listen to it in a minute. So thank you so much, Jazzie. And Jazzie's going to come back up and he'll answer some of your own questions. So please give a hand to Jazzie.